In this demonstration, I'd like to give you the opportunity to see a whole brain in three dimensions. In the lectures, you're going to see images of the brain, but in this one, in this demonstration, I hope to kind of rotate it around so you can see its three-dimensionality. So this is a whole plastinated brain. This is the anterior pole, the posterior pole, and then one of the main reasons you know that is because you can see the cerebellum back here in the back. Some of the landmarks that we've talked about in the lecture include the precentral gyrus, which is here, and the postcentral gyrus, which is here. Now, the main thing that divides the two gyri is this central sulcus. The central sulcus is a major landmark, and it's really important because this landmark separates the affective half of your brain, the part where you think and plan, and the sensory half or preceptive part of your brain, which is the posterior half. So the central sulcus starts at the top here along the superior longitudinal fissure or superior sagittal sulcus. You'll hear both names. And it goes all the way down to the lateral sulcus, which is here. And the lateral sulcus separates your temporal lobe from your frontal lobe and your parietal lobe. Now the central sulcus also separates then your frontal lobe from your parietal lobe. So these are the three lobes that you can see very easily on the lateral surface of the brain: frontal, parietal, and temporal. You can also see your occipital lobe, which is way back here in the back, and we don't have a real solid landmark for distinguishing a border between the parietal lobe and the occipital lobe. We kind of draw an imaginary line that kind of leads from the extension of the lateral fissure kind of down toward this region in here. There's a very clear landmark on the medial surface of the brain that I'll show you in a minute. So here's the lateral surface: frontal, parietal, occipital, temporal, lateral fissure, and central sulcus, precentral gyrus, postcentral gyrus. The other two things I want you to remember from the lecture that are important about that precentral gyrus is that's your primary motor cortex. So you think about moving up here, you actually start moving here. These are the neurons that talk to the ones in your brainstem and spinal cord, which initiate voluntary movement. This postcentral gyrus is your primary somatosensory cortex. And that is where any kind of sensation from your periphery, so where that mosquito bit you, you know exactly where it is because those neurons project to this sulcus, or this gyrus here. Okay, so looking at the brain, we can rotate it. Here you see it from the front. This side does not have any arachnoid remaining. It's all been peeled away, so you can just see the reason it's nice and smooth is because the pia is still attached. On this side, on the right hemisphere, we still have the arachnoid attached to this side of the brain. And that's why it looks kind of more opaque. There looks like there's a kind of a filmy layer on top. And that's the result of the arachnoid being collapsed and kind of a thicker layer over the surface of the brain. So the landmarks are a little harder to see on this side. You can still see the lateral fissure, but it's really hard to distinguish that central sulcus. But you still know that this is going to be the frontal lobe, parietal lobe, occipital lobe, and temporal lobe. From the back, you can clearly see the cerebellum. The cerebellum means little brain, and you've got a ton of neurons back here. We'll talk about that in the cerebellum and motor systems lecture, but there are almost as many neurons in here as there are in the whole rest of the brain. Underneath, let me flip so that you're looking at it kind of right side up. So here again is our frontal lobe, and here are our temporal lobes, and here's our brainstem. You can clearly see the pons and the medulla, and you can then also see part of the cerebellum. You can see also, we have one big blood vessel here. This is going to be the basilar artery and part of the vertebral. It's just one of those horrible facts of life that on plastinated brains, the vasculature doesn't survive very long. It's a kind of fragile, and it often will fall off from years of students using the brains. But we still have a basilar and a vertebral. You can also see our optic nerves here and here coming together to form the optic chiasm. And you can see just a little bit of the olfactory nerves. The olfactory bulb is missing on this side. You can see part of it here. And I'll have better examples of this in future demos. I just basically wanted you to get familiar with the underside of the brain. This is the side of the brain that fits on the skull base. And of course, the top is what is seated in the cranial vault. Two more lobes that I want to talk about that you can't really see from a whole intact brain. So I'm going to set this to the side and pull up this one. So just deep to the lateral fissure, let's get the right side. So the lateral fissure is here. If you open that up, you would see just deep to it is our insular lobe. And that's this gray matter here. This is another example of the fact that your brain is too big for your body, for your head. That's clear because it's thrown into all of these folds. The gyri are the big lumps and the sulci are the folds. And it's folded because your brain's too big for your head. So you have to fold it up to fit it in there. And this is further evidence of that, that you even fold the folds so that you have the insula buried underneath the rest of the cortex. On the medial surface of the brain, if you cut the brain in half, if you just whack right through there with a big knife, it's called a brain knife, you end up with this view. Okay? And again, you can see the frontal lobe here and the parietal lobe. And here's that big landmark I wanted to point out, the occipital, parieto-occipital sulcus, which is right here. And that clearly separates the parietal lobe, the parietal lobe here from the occipital lobe here. You can see your brainstem. You can see the cerebellum. And you can see this also this big band of fibers here, which is really important. This is your corpus callosum. We'll talk more about this in the lecture about the white matter that in the cortex. But the bottom line is that the corpus callosum attaches your hemispheres together. It is literally how your right hand knows what your left hand is doing. Okay, this area is a very special area of the brain called the diencephalon. And the diencephalon includes the thalamus and the hypothalamus. And those are very important areas for, the thalamus is a sensory gateway. All of your sensations come through the thalamus before they go up to the cortex, before they go up to that postcentral gyrus. And the hypothalamus is a very important regulatory center when it comes to metabolism, endocrinology, and basic drives, survival drives, like to get a drink of water or to eat. Again, we can see our brainstem. This is the pons. This is the midbrain, which you can't see from the underneath, but you can see it here, and our medulla. You can see just the edge of the temporal lobe here. The other lobe I wanted to show you, I showed you the insula. Can't see it on this one. Got to go back to this one. So, I know what I wanted to say. You can see into the lateral ventricles. We're going to talk about the ventricles in another demo, but you can see that you do have holes in your brain. And that's not important right now. We'll talk more about that in the next demo. So, corpus callosum. Back to our other brain where we saw our insula. If we also look on the midline, there's another structure called the limbic lobe. And the limbic lobe crosses the borders of the frontal and the parietal and the occipital, almost the occipital, not quite, the frontal and the parietal and the temporal. And it's not as anatomical a lobe, although it does have some anatomical features. It's more of a functional lobe. And it follows this gyrus, which is called the cingulate gyrus. And it goes right above, it's right up on top of the corpus callosum, which is here. So this cingulate gyrus comes all the way around, so from the frontal lobe into the parietal lobe, and then it dips down, and we also include this region, which is called the parahippocampal gyrus. to here. So you can, it forms this semicircle or limbus. Limbus is, I don't know, Greek or Latin for circle. And so it, this limbic lobe here is defined by the parahippocampal gyrus, the collateral sulcus, the cingulate gyrus here. Those are the major landmarks that you can see on most brains. They're going to vary a little bit from brain to brain, but in general, they're pretty consistent. Here's the lateral sulcus again. Here's our central sulcus, or our lateral fissure, central sulcus. On this one, again, here's our lateral fissure. And it's really hard to see the central sulcus on this brain. I would hazard a guess and say it's probably this one. But you can see that this one's not as clear as some of the others. So as you move forward in your neuroanatomical education, you have to realize that there's going to be some variability. And that concludes my demonstration of all of the things you can see grossly on the outside of the brain.